So we're very excited about this next panel. This is very personal for me. Been looking forward to it for a long time. Our longtime friend Dee-1 is here. Y'all know about Dee-1. New Orleans rapper who has been working in the trenches for so many years. Major label recording artist, RCA recording artist, right? Mm-hmm. Broke through, as you all know, very recently with his song Sally Maybach, which generated 3 million views in the first week. Not a bad way to start. And he is going to have a conversation with our man, Ibrahim Hamad, who is the president and CEO of Dreamville Records and the manager of J. Cole, who is coincidentally, right, headlining Jazz Fest today, and other artists as well that he'll be happy to talk about. But these guys are going to give us a little bit of information on the business side of how they have approached their respective careers. But as a way to warm things up, we're going to start with a little bit of music. So, Tony, if we could roll a little bit of that Dee-1 clip and then a little bit of that Cole clip, and we'll get into the conversation. Thank you all for being here.
Paperwork. I need your parents' tax information from 2015, 2014, 2013, a non-refundable check for $125.
I'm finished!
Yeah. True story.
I can tell by how I treat you with my girl. Damn, she's so selfless, but she put up with my ways because she love me like you do. And no, it don't always show. I love her just like I love you. And I need to treat you better.
Thank you all for attending this session. This is going to be extremely fun for me because this is a brother I've been knowing for a few years now. Just we've been on the same grind, hustling, working hard, and I think one thing I enjoy about Ibe is he's never been one of those people who was doing it just for the fame, because you can identify those people from a mile away. So a lot of people, I don't think, know the man behind Dreamville, the man behind J. Cole, you know, and the management side, and that's the goal of today, as well as learning some tips about how to make it in the music industry, because I'm sure everyone in here wants to move further in their artistry. So thank you for joining us in my city, bro.
No problem, man. You know I love New Orleans.
I know that. So starting off, since you love New Orleans, we want to know, where are you from, brother?
I grew up in New York. My parents are from Sudan in Africa. And I was actually born in France because my father worked for the United Nations, so we moved around a lot. But I grew up in New York, and you know, that's home for me, New York. So that's where I grew up. That's where I went to high school. I stayed there for college. Yep. And you know, that's where I've always been for the most part.
Believe that. King of Queens, huh?
Queens, New York.
Believe that. So describe your relationship with music growing up.
I have to say my older brother was a big influence because he's a DJ, but even before that, he was a rapper. And, you know, just growing up, I remember he used to go and buy every single, like, rap CD in the store when it would come out on whenever the release day was, Tuesday. And, you know, because it was still fresh and new at that time. It wasn't like today where there's, like, you know, 300,000 rappers dropping a song a day. It was like 10 albums that would come out 1 week, and he would just go grab everything. And I used to just sit there and, like, go through his CDs, and that's how I got introduced to music.
All right, name three of your favorite artists growing up.
Jodeci was my favorite.
Word.
Yeah, I was a huge Jodeci fan.
Okay.
Nas, you know, okay. Especially when I moved to Queens, it was kind of like, oh, this guy's from right here.
Yeah.
And I would have to say Tupac. Tupac was like one of my favorite, because my other brother was like a huge Tupac fan, so it's like, that's how I got to him.
Straight up. Cool, that's a cool mix. Jodeci, that shocked me.
Man, I used to like want to sing it like in the mirror like them when I was a kid.
Okay.
Then I hit puberty and everything.
Okay.
My voice wasn't the same. But nah, I love Jodeci, man. I was having this conversation with somebody the other day. It was weird because at a young age, I realized that Jodeci like was writing and producing their own stuff. Mm-hmm. And I don't know why that was so important to me. I was like, oh, they're dope. They write and they produce.
Yep.
And it's like, who really cared? I was like 8, 9, but I love that about them.
Dig that. But when you get older and you find out that some of our favorite R&B artists, all they do is go in there and sing a song that people have pre-written and pre-referenced, it kind of takes some of the...
For sure. I think, but, you know, artists are still, it's like the artist is an instrument at the end of the day too, you know? So their voice, even though they didn't write it, the other artists probably couldn't pull it off the same. And there's a reason why that writer gave it to that artist, because he couldn't pull it off, make it happen like that artist could. So it never really like made me dislike the artist or dislike the music. I just appreciated people that, you know, wrote what they were talking about that they were living.
Believe that. Did you have an affinity for any artists from New Orleans growing up? I know you were familiar with what was coming from down here.
I definitely bought the High Boys album.
Which one? Which
the
album?
First one.
The first one?
Yeah.
You remember the name of it?
Something with fire, bro. I just remember the cover had. I just remember hearing, because you know I'm from New York,
so get it
the
how you
song
live.
That broke to us was Juvenile.
Huh.
And we was like, damn, what is that? Like, this is crazy. This is new. What do you say?
Yeah.
Like, you got on your Jibbo jeans.
Yeah. Okay. But, you keep your body clean, right?
So that, and then I got introduced to the Hobble. And I think being young, I gravitated towards like Turk and Wein.
Cause they was the youngest.
They were the young ones. So then, you know, I got that album and I didn't really understand what was going on in New Orleans or what they were talking about,
right.
But it was just entertaining. And plus, y'all got the best accents in the world. So
Believe that.
It was cool to hear rappers rapping like that.
Believe that. So moving past middle school and high school years, you attended St. John's University, right?
Correct.
Cool. What attracted you to St. John's, and what did you major in?
Well, St. John's was right down the block from me. So initially, when I played basketball in high school, so I thought I was going to try to go somewhere and play basketball, but I just kind of slacked on that. And then my older brother went to St. John's, so I just kind of knew. I knew it was a good school, and I knew it was like a big school in New York. So I just lacked and go to St. John's and walk to class from home.
Dig that. Yeah.
I didn't get the experience of like living in a dorm room or anything. But I loved it because I was still at home. And in St. John's at the time, the dorms were kind of new, so you had a lot of people coming from out of state to come to school in New York. Mm-hmm. And that was a new experience for us, and I loved that part of it too.
Dig that. What did you major in?
Communication.
Okay.
You know, that's the major for like when you're not sure.
When you ain't sure, yeah, yeah.
So I did that.
Dig that. Did you have a full scholarship to college? Did you pay or did you have your parents pay?
No, I grew up with both my parents, and my dad like really took care of all of us, you know, like the family. There was no slacking, and you know, like, so he made sure we was good. And plus where he worked at, it was like he had to pay for like the first year or two when I was in college. He like paid and got like 75% back from his job or whatever. But then I had to take out loans.
Oh, so you had to pay Sallie Mae back eventually. Exactly. Yeah.
I actually just finished up too. So.
You did? Congratulations, yeah, dude. Hey, y'all make some noise for him. Real talk.
Yeah, they'll stay on your ass.
Yeah, bro, they stay on you straight up. And you'll be running around here with buku Instagram followers and popular and famous, but you still owe Sally me. You know what I'm saying? That's real. So, all right. Do you remember the first time that you met J. Cole, and what was y'all relationship like early on?
We used to play basketball like during what we used to call common hour.
Yeah.
Which is like
at the rec.
There was like an hour and a half in Tuesdays and Thursdays when nobody had class, like in the middle of the day, like around lunchtime, and all the like we used to just all go to the gym and play ball. And that's how I kind of met him, but I didn't really know him. I just knew that he was tall and he was a guard, like kind of like me. Mm-hmm. So I just had to go at him every time.
Right.
And that's kind of how we met, but it was never like anything related to music. I didn't know he did music.
You didn't know he did music?
No, I didn't know he did music at all, because he kind of, it was like a hidden thing. Mm-hmm. Like he had this theory that he didn't want to be like everybody, like I'm a rapper. Especially at that time, everybody's a rapper now, but back then.
Everybody.
And he didn't want to, like, have that stigma, so nobody really knew. And then when we got cool, probably, like, his junior year, senior year, you know, I was from there. He was, you know, in New York, so a lot of times we would just go out, and I just knew different promoters, and we would go out and chill and drink in the, I don't promote this, drink on the way to the party. And then one day I accidentally heard his music. Because he had, like, his CD in, and I heard something. I'm like, damn, who's that? He's like, oh, that's my shit. I'm like, my nigga, like, why does nobody know about this? And he was like, nah, I'm just waiting. I'm going to get a deal, and then people going to see. And I'm like, that's cool, but it doesn't really work that easy, you know what I mean? So that's kind of how we started linking.
Nice. So were you a part of that story? And I'll let you tell the story more than me. The story involving Cole wanting to get like a beat CD to Jay-Z, and you were a part of that.
I was there.
So tell it, let everybody know about that story.
He was at work, because at the time he was working selling ads for a newspaper. Mm-hmm. A job I got fired from, and I brought him in there, and shit's fucked up.
Wow.
But then I was working in my other job, and he called me because he seen a press release about American Gangster. You know, Jay wasn't really working on albums like that at the time. Right. So he was like, yo, Jay's working on an album. And he had done a beat with a crazy hook on it. We was like, yo, we should get that to Jay. So he made like this fake cover. I think he like flipped Volume 2's cover, and he had like a picture of Jay on it, put it in the box. And he had like two beats on it. And he was like, yo, I'm going to go over there. And I know what he'd be working out of. You know, like we kind of had an idea. Mm-hmm. So we just went over there. We took the train. I remember it was pouring rain, and we just waited outside, got a little bottle of E&J to kill time.
Yeah.
And because that's all we could afford at the time, too. And then we just waited outside, and it was just pouring, and we was there for a few hours just talking. Obviously, just, you know, whatever we would do, just fucking around. And then we seen a Phantom pull up.
Man, that heart started beating fast.
For sure, especially his. I was looking at him like, what you gonna do now?
Yeah.
but that Phantom look, man, I had never seen nothing like that. So it pulled up, you know how they say like some artists have that glow?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I've seen that glow like probably like four times in my life.
Dang.
But he pulled up and we were just weighing, and then when he came out, Cole was like, Jay. And you know, looking back, this is gonna sound like fucked up, but looking like knowing where I'm at now, I understand what Jay was doing, but he was just like, he was like, Jay, and Jay was like, what's that? And Cole was like a little nervous, like, it's American Gangster, like as if that was the album.
Yeah.
And then Jay was like, man, I don't want that. Give it to one of those guys. Mm. And then we was kind of hurt, like,
yeah.
Yo, that's fucked up. Like, yeah, Jay, you can't do that too.
He supposed to take that, yeah. Right.
But I remember, well, we ended up bringing it up later, but I remember him telling us that at the time, artists were getting sued for like I think Kanye had just gotten sued for like, you could take a beat CD and it might not have nothing on it, and then you drop a song, and then the producer's like, oh, I gave him that snare.
Wow.
I gave him that idea. So sometimes they would kind of like shine away from that. But we left, and then we waited outside, like kind of like, man, did that just happen?
Wow.
And then Beyonce walked out. We was like, oh, shit.
Wow, bro.
Beyonce. So that was like the memory of that night, too.
Man.
And then we just left, and I think really reality hit us that that's not how it was going to work.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's not how he was going to get on. He wasn't just going to give Jay-Z a CD and Jay-Z. Because we really thought he was going to give him the CD. Jay was going to go upstairs, listen to it, and be like, send somebody down and be like, somebody go get that kid. Like,
yep.
But it's not going to work like that. Like, I mean, that's Disney movie. You know what I mean? But we knew it was going to work like that. And I think we needed that to happen to kind of be like, all right, how are we going to approach it now? What are we going to do next? You know?
Yeah. We got to grind. Believe it. That's a wonderful story, man. Any artists in the room, just by show of hands, does anyone have a similar type of story? You know what I mean? No? Yeah, like, I know a couple of us do. People who know me well know I got a Manny Fresh story that's just like that. Really, but I met him in AutoZone, literally. Like, yeah, and I just walked in aisle 3, and he was buying some spark plugs, and I was like, And I called my homie Zella, and I said, bro, Manny Fresh is in aisle 3. He said, well, hang up with me and go give him your mixtape. You know what I mean? So I gave it to him. I had my cell phone number on there, and I just pulled off, man. I had an old Oldsmobile Achiever at the time, and the window didn't work, so I opened the door. And when I was pulling off, I was like, Fresh, I'm waiting to hear from you. Call me after you listen. And he ain't called me for like 4 years, you know what I mean?
Did he call you after 4 years?
He called me because he saw one of my videos on MTV Jams.
He saw the work,
you know what I mean? So
that's dope.
And then we did music, so that's cool. But did you ever want to be an artist at any time in your life?
Nah, it wasn't for me. I was a fan of the music. And I was a fan of music that like touched me or like, you know, inspired me or something that made me like really think. Or not necessarily think, like it has to be like conscious music. I just like music that affected me, something that made me feel like, oh, he just said that, like, oh, I know how that feels. And I just like being a fan of it. I didn't know I wanted to work in music neither. Like, I knew I was into sports heavy. I still am, but I mean, I wanted to, like, work at a front office or, like, a sports agency.
Yep.
But I felt like, you know, everything happens for a reason. It just kind of fell in my lap, I guess, you know what I mean? And I just, it didn't start like, oh, here's Cole, this is my friend, I'm gonna be his manager. It was like, yo, this is my friend, this is my homie. Let me see how I could tell as many people that he's dope. That's really how it started. I was just going around Queens, all my homies back home, like, yo, my homie, because Jermaine used to be like, light skin Jermaine, like, that's what he used.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, he's like, yo, he can rap. Word? And I would play something, be like, oh, he can rap. And that was it. That was the fun part. Like, yo, my friend can rap. You should check it out.
Being able to rap.
You know what I mean? And that's kind of how it started.
So how did you go from being Jermaine's partner to being formerly a part of his management team? Like, you know?
I think he just trusted. I think it was a trust thing. Because what happened is, you know, I would chill with him. Then I would give him advice. Or be like, yo, we should, like, first I was like, we should do the come up. Like, we should put a CD together, go hand it out around Queens or whatever we got to do. And then initially, you know, I never wanted to overstep my boundaries. So this was like way before he was signed. So we would go to the studio. First, it started with me going to the studio with him. All right. You know what I mean? Because I was like, you know, somebody trusted, we go. And I'd be like, yo, that's dope. Maybe you should do it, you know, at a different tone. Or maybe you should put this part here. And they would be like, oh, that's a good idea. And I think that trust kind of started being like, okay, I trust you enough to bounce back ideas with you. I trust you enough to like allow you into what I'm doing. Because I know, you know, I always had, like, with any artist I work, I'm just going to have their best interest at heart. Because to me, that's what's more important. Whatever they're trying to accomplish, whatever they're trying to do, that's the most important part. So that's what I was trying to do.
Man, you have a very selfless spirit about you because, you know, growing up in our generation, I mean, we grew up in the era of, you know, Puffy, who didn't start out as an artist, but Puffy is like the dude that, hey, I'm the manager, I'm the behind-the-scenes producer, but I'm going to be all in the videos, you know, that type of thing. You got, you know, down here, I mean, you got your people like Birdman, who was a very central figure, you know what I'm saying? And what do you think? You think it's your family upbringing? Like, what do you think it was that, because you definitely have a selfless vibe about you that's kind of rare.
I mean, that's not what I do, you know what I mean? Like, that's not who I am. I'm not an artist. I'm not the guy that wants to be in the video and, like, you know, dancing, like, in the video, you know. That's cool. No, it's cool because, to me, Puffy made Biggie better. Yeah. You know what I mean? Birdman made Wein better because that was, like, a dynamic that they had. I feel like I make Cole's music or his brand better from what I do behind the scenes. I don't need to be in the front because that's not for me. Like, what am I going to, well, I'm just going to stand next to him and be like point at
right,
him.
Right.
I'm not rapping. So to me, it's like, that was never my thing. And my validation or my, like, joy from this was seeing him or seeing the artists we work with win. Because mm-hmm. then I knew the reason I'm working with artists or the reason I'm working with Cole is because I feel like, man, what he's saying could affect people. What he's saying can touch people. So when I see that it has, that's the win. Like,
okay.
When I see fans reacting to it, I'm like, I'm the kind of guy when a song comes out, when we put out a song, because we used to do this all the time, and it's good and it's bad, I would, like, stay on Twitter for, like, 2 hours reading every comment. Like, damn, yeah. That's exactly what we wanted them to say.
Nice.
You know what I mean? And that's really the validation. That's the fun part.
Nice. So what we're doing right now, y'all, is we're going on a timeline just so you all can see this man from a young buck, you know what I mean, in Queens to coming up through high school, being an ordinary dude, going to college, and as things progress to where now he's an industry professional and veteran. So with that being said, did you finish college?
No.
Oh.
I had some loan problems, plus I was like, I was just running around, just should have been in class sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
And then right when I was like kind of getting ready to, you know, finish or, you know, just kind of, put a bow on it, mm-hmm. or, you know, I knew it would be like a year and a half left, is when things started picking up with Cole, and I was kind of like, I mean, I wish I finished college, and I think people should finish college, but for me, it was kind of like, even if I finished college, I was going to be doing this, because I knew at that point, like, oh, this is what I'm about to do.
Straight up.
Like, you know, we had invested so much time into it that I knew what I was going to do.
Word.
So, no, I didn't finish college. I wish I would have, though, just for my mom.
Believe that. It's still possible, big yeah, brother. You true. Already knew. So, describe that time that a lot of people in here can relate to, the time between you're not a full-time student anymore, but stuff hasn't taken off with Cole yet to where this is what you make a living off of. What was that 9-to-5 time or that, you know, just getting it out the mud time like?
Man.
What did you do?
We were definitely broke. Like, I had I always had a good family that, like, I was never, like, broke. You know, I was good. I had a place to stay. You know what I mean? They would make sure I'm eating. But he was broke, and it was kind of like a moment of, like, just trying to figure it out. And I remember him telling me once he graduated, he was like, I'm not going to get a 9-to-5, because if I get a 9-to-5, I'm, like, getting away from what I'm supposed to be doing. So we was just bouncing around from part-time jobs just so he could pay his rent and eat. But he knew that if he had, like, a real 9-to-5, like the rest of his friends that graduated, it would take away too much time mm-hmm. from the music. Mm-hmm. So that's what it was at first. We were selling ad at a newspaper in Queens.
Wow.
And my older brother was working there. It was like, man, we was running the system. My older
Scheme.
Brother was working there. Then he bought my other brother and a couple of my homeboys. Then he bought me in. And then I bought Cole in. Then right. I got fired. And I found another job. And then
wow.
I bought Cole in.
Wow.
And it was kind of like, it was like these little part-time jobs that were just keeping us afloat. But what I will say is that Cole, he never strayed away from what he wanted to do. So it's kind of like he never really made music to get signed. He was just like, I'm going to make the best song, and I know somebody's going to find this. Mm. Like, it's not like I'm going to make the music that sounds like this. It's like I'm going to make the best song or the best songs or project I can make, and I know somebody's going to find it. So that was kind of like what was going on at the time, because I think we used to always talk about it. We were almost fooling ourselves. like, we almost always felt like the deal was right around the corner. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what kept us going. We would always be like, man, this is too good. Like, somebody's going to sign you next week. Like, you know, and it just kept you going. It kept you motivated. It was never like, man, this is not going to happen. Because then that's when you, like, you beat yourself. So I think we just kept going by lying to ourselves. Like, yo, I know this is about to happen.
Believe it.
And that's kind of like, that was like the, and we was having fun with it. Mm-hmm. You know, we was having a lot of fun with it. Like, we put whatever money, we literally just talking about it yesterday, me, him, and my boy Mike. We were going to North Carolina A&T for like their homecoming, because, you know, they're from North Carolina. And he would be like, and we would like put whatever money we had together to press up CDs on Jamaica Avenue. And what we was doing, we was really going around to people, and that's really where the Dollar and the Dream thing started from. We was going around to people, like, trying to get them to buy the come up for a dollar, because we was like, look, if we charge you $5, you're not going to buy it. If we give it to you for free, you're going to throw it out.
A dollar.
If we charge you a dollar, you at least going to listen to one song.
Dumb.
And we knew if you listen to one song, we got you. Like that. But we were having fun with it. Like, we was going around joking with people. You know, we like, we was doing like what kids would do at the time, like just run around, go up to people, talk shit, and then be like, they'd be like, how am I supposed to know this is good? I'm like, word, you want to find out? Yo, Cole, come spit. Like,
yeah.
He literally was running around campus in North Carolina just rapping for people. And then they'd be like, oh, he's dope. And, you know, it was just fun for us. So I think keeping it fun, keeping it lighthearted, and knowing that it was going to happen is kind of what kept us going.
Oh, I did the same stuff, dog. I'm just laughing, bro. And if the girl looked good, I'd give it to her for free. You know, she ain't had to pay a dollar. If it was a girl who looked good, like, oh, you get that for free. Let me get that number. But, yeah. So, with that being said, we have some people out here who formerly went to school to learn the music business. You know what I mean? We have the Loyola School of School of Music Business down here. You got people who are getting degrees in this nowadays. With you, you had to learn on the job. So, what was that like, man? Just being like, yo, I have no formal training in this. This is all get it how you live.
Man, I loved it, cause I didn't come in with any of the rules that like labels would teach you, especially at that time. You know, like everybody was in a box, everybody was following these rules. And when I came in, you know, I wasn't Cole's manager. Like, I was doing a lot of managerial things and you know, just giving him the same input, but I was just getting to sit back and learn. We were all learning, really, you know what I mean? It was me, Cole, Adam, who's here, who's his, you know, he was his freshman roommate, you know what I mean? Like, and he's from here. Mm-hmm. So it's like, we were just kind of learning on our own. Like, all right, well, we know we have music, and then we had the internet, and what we were doing from day one was like, all right, we have these fans right here. We know they fuck with J. Cole. What can we do to get them excited? What can we do to, you know, just feed them and let them do the talking? So it was like figuring it out as we go. It was never, you know, we played the game of like reaching out and trying to get these imaginary fans, but that's a hard game to play. So what we were doing is just figuring it out. We was like, okay, let's drop a song at 3 a.m. because, you know, the fans that are up are going to feel special about it. And the fans that are not up, they're going to get text messages and calls from the other fans like, yo, Cole just dropped the song. And, you know, you remember those moments. And we were all about trying to create these moments and just trying to, and we were always, like, that allowed it, those early days allowed us to get to where we were at, you know, recently, where we could think out the box with what we want to do. Because we had to learn to think out the box, because the game was still in the box, you know, and like it was still like, where's your single? Put the single out. All right, you got this many spins. All right, now you're ready for an album. You know what I mean? And we never really believed that was for us.
Right. So once you came in the game and people started to see, all right, Ebe is Cole's right hand. Like, wherever Cole is, you're going to see Ebe. Did anybody in the game kind of choose to become a mentor for you and take you under their wing? Like, since I see that you're going to be around, I'm going to, you know, show you the ropes a little bit.
I would say I had a few people that I would go to and really talk to, but it was more like, I never understood the term mentor, because I never like really had a mentor that was like, this is how you, but I had a lot of people around me that taught me things, you know, like, whether it's Cole's management, at the time was Mark Pitts and Wayne Barrow. So it's like, you know, Mark used to manage Biggie. So I would ask questions like, and then No ID, who really was the first person that we really got into the studio with, mm-hmm. when we was working on that first album. And he put us on so much game. Me and Cole used to have like this joke. We'd be like, yo, if we get in with No ID, we need 2 days. One day just to talk. and then we'll work the next day because he always got gems. He always got game. And you know, there was a couple other people like Shaka Pilgrim, who works at Rock Nation, who came up with Jay, who's like, you know, Jay's right hand. She taught me a lot in Ethiopia over at Universal. So it's like different people that worked with us that were genuinely like cared about us and cared about Cole's career and cared about my career, you know? And I looked at those people as friends and got to ask them questions. So that, I guess that would be my mentors.
Right, believe that. Cause I knew you already from, you know, just meeting a few times, but I know I would hear your name constantly come up from Just Garcia.
Oh, that's my man.
Yeah, Just.
Just was the first, like, cause Just worked for Mark.
Yeah, exactly, so
Just, man, Just is my man. Cause he worked for Mark, but he was like, our generation.
Ground level,
so,
yeah.
He's so we could go to the party with him and talk yep. shit, or we could talk business with him.
Yep.
And yeah, Just was definitely, you know what Just did for me that was important, I guess, is he kind of gave me, like he would hold me, let me know basically like how to conversate to the building too. Like mm-hmm. it was almost like I got to see him and knew like you can, whatever you want to say that you would say to like your people or your generation, there's a certain way you could say it to the building. Mm-hmm. And he was good at that.
Believe that. That's what's up. When it comes to managing each and every artist is different, you know, because we are, sure. you know, we're like these different creatures, you know, from another planet. And with that being said, when it comes to J. Cole specifically, what would you say would have been the main responsibilities that you felt on your heart? Yo, I need to do X, Y, and Z to effectively manage Cole specifically. Like, what areas you feel like?
I think with Cole, he's like this. There's no doubt in his mind what he wants to do. Like, there's no, like he knows what he wants to do. So, with me, it's always like, let me just help him get there. But also, it was like an honesty thing. Like, with an artist, you can't just be like, yo, you shouldn't do that. Or like, yo, that's not a good idea. You have to know how to communicate that to them. And being that I was my friend first, I knew how to communicate things to them. So, it was like, yo, maybe, you know, it's like, sometimes he'll get mad and be like, yo, just say it. Like, say how you feel. Sometimes I'll be like, he'll get it. Like, cause I could tell him something and he'll disagree with me. And then hit me back 3 days later, like, yo, that thing you said, why did you say it? You know what I mean? And then it becomes a conversation. So to me, it was about being honest with him. And then after the honesty part, it was really just about helping him get to where he needs to get or where he wants to get. You know, like making that better or figuring things out for him to make it easy on him. Cause you know, you guys have a hard job. You gotta make them, it's, making the music itself is hard enough, you know what I mean? So it's like, but he, not only does he produce the music and you know, write the raps, he also has an idea of how he wants his album to come out. So then that's when me, him, and Adam would get in the room and had a conversation. What's the best way to do it? How do we do this? How can we accomplish this? And I think that's why I looked at myself as like, I knew he trusted me enough that he would take my advice and my criticism on things, but I also knew that you know, this is not my career. This is his career. I'm here to help him. And that's how I look at it with any artist. You know what I mean? Like, I think all artists should have a vision for themselves. I don't think it should be a label or a manager to create your vision. Because then it's inauthentic. It's not authentic at that point. It's just kind of like you're going with what people are telling you. And you're only going to hate yourself at the end if it doesn't work out. You know, if it didn't work out with my plan, you're gonna blame me. You know what I mean? And that's really not fair to the artist. I think the artist should have their own vision. And if they don't have a vision, you kind of like walk them through until they build their own vision. You kind of like give them that. Because all of this is confidence. You give them the confidence like, look, this is your career. This is your career. Like, you really got to know what you want to do. And with Cole, that was never a problem. Like, he knew what he wanted to do from jump.
Dig that. What you think is the biggest misconception about being a manager that people who aren't managers may think like, okay, like I know that for me, I used to hunt down famous artist managers because I was like, oh, that person could put me on, like Jason Jeter. Oh, he put T.I. on, he could put me on. I made a song called Jason Jeter, you know, about trying to get at him, like that type of stuff. What you think are the biggest misconceptions that outsiders have about you all?
I think the biggest misconception is that a manager that manages a big artist can just put somebody on. He could walk you into a building, but it don't mean shit if your music is not good or if your music doesn't connect. My thing was always like, I kind of, personally, I have like, I don't like management companies where like you have this big management name and then it's like people under you that's managing the artist. Mm-hmm. I feel like that's like, you know, selling artists a dream that's not true. Cause you're like, oh, I'm gonna get managed by blah, blah, blah. But really it's this person appointed to you. And I never wanted to be a part of that. And I think that for me, I've met tons of artists that are super dope. And I could easily be like, oh, that's not for me. Like you're gonna make it, you're super dope, but it's not for me. Like I'm not just gonna take this on because I know there's money there. Because to me, it's like I gotta be passionate. I gotta like really love it and wanna work on it every day. I gotta wake up and be like, how are we gonna figure this out? And you know, like I think that's the biggest misconception is people go to management groups or management like high profile name managers, but that high profile name manager got three other high profile artists. So then you kind of like, you know, fall to the side, and then you like, fuck, why am I even here? I hate those situations for the artist, you know what I mean? So that's the biggest misconception is that a manager's name is gonna really take off your career. I've had conversations with plenty of artists that are on, that are not on, and I always tell them like work from within. Like find somebody in your team, they might not know nothing, but they just got that passion and they gonna figure it out, like build them up. You know, cause I felt like Cole did that for me, you know what I mean? Like he gave me the chance to like really learn and like he built me up to be where I'm at right now because he was like, okay, this guy's gonna find a way. You know what I mean? He gonna figure it out however because he really cares. And I think that's the best managers to have is people that are attached to your project, people that are attached to your every move. Mm-hmm.
So what is it? Yeah, they clapping. That's real. What it, cause y'all know, man, you meet somebody and they like, yeah, bro, I manage 9 artists. And you like, who you manage? What's their name? And they start naming people and you like, I don't know any of those people, my brother, you know? And yeah, what you say? Right. What is it that made you not want to take on buku artists, you know what I'm saying? Like in the beginning. And what is it that they currently like what do you have on your plate management wise currently?
Well, in the beginning, I just wasn't in no position to do it, you know? Mm-hmm. Like I look at it like in the beginning and even till today, like managing Cole it's like a 24-hour job. At any point you gotta be ready to do something, you know what I mean? Or it's like, yo, we gotta do this, or yo, I had an idea, you gotta be on your toes. So but in the beginning I had no means. Even, you know, even when we first started working, me and Cole, and he was trying to get on, it's not like I had the money to move around. Like, right. He was barely making, like, money in the beginning, so how am I going to make it? So in the beginning, it was really not any means for me to do anything. And then after a while, what I just learned was, like, oh, I really just enjoy working with things I love and things that excite me. I got to be a fan, you know what I mean? Like, I got to be a fan first, and that's hard. Like, it's not a lot of things that you're going to be a super fan of, you know what I mean? And what ended up happening is when we started Dreamville, that was like kind of like the state of mind was anybody we sign or anybody we work with, we have to be fans of, you know? Me and Cole, Adam, we have to agree. Like, we have to be there and be like, okay, we all agree on this, right? It's not like, yo, I like that. And then somebody else like, I'm cool on that, you know? Because we need everybody on the same page. Like, our team is built a little different. We're like a family, you know what I mean? And like even our artists, I go to artists we have now when we're about to sign a new artist. Like, yo, what you think? Because I know they're gonna have an input, and I know they're gonna be a part of it. Mm. You know what I mean? And they're all gonna be a family. So to me, in the beginning, I didn't have the means. Now, I only manage Cole, but I also oversee like Boz, Kaz, Omen, Luke, Ari, and they have their own managers. But you know, I'm always gonna be there to give my input, and I'm always gonna be there to work with, because their managers are like family. Their managers worked with us on Cole. It's not like it's these outside people, you know what I mean? So to me, I oversee them, and I kind of work as like an overseer management kind of guy, mm-hmm. But they have their own team. They have their own vision. Mm-hmm. I'm just, like I said, I'm just there to make it better. I'm not here to like, you know, take on what you have and be like, nah, we doing something different.
Believe that. That's cool. What's the most difficult part about managing J. Cole for you?
I mean, he's probably a little stubborn, but nah, but it's great. He knows what he wants, and when he wants something, it's like it's our job to try to like work around it. And sometimes we might not have the same idea, mm-hmm. And, you know, me and Adam will talk like, man, I think he's wrong. And then we'll go and tell him, like, yo, I think you're wrong, but it might not matter. Or, but he'll always listen. He'll always value your opinion and be like, well, if they think I'm wrong, there must be a reason. It might not change his final, you know, but he has the final say at the end of the day. It's his career, you know what I mean? So I wouldn't say it's much of a problem. I think he knows what he wants to do. So you have to kind of work within that. And he's always going to, like, he's never going to play any game anymore. Like, he's not gonna, like, play that game. He's not doing an interview if he doesn't want to do an interview. Yeah. He's not getting in the studio with, no matter who the artist is, if he doesn't want to get in the studio with them. So it's like, you have to respect that, you know what I mean? At the end of the day, he's a man first, like the music, mm-hmm. that's second, you know what I mean? So you have to respect that and kind of play within those lines.
Mm-hmm. How much of a part of your job is kind of like helping to insulate Cole, or, you know, being that buffer between everybody and their mama wants, like you said, an interview, they want a piece of his time, they want to meet, that's the hard, talk about that part.
It's the hard part because you're a representation, I'm a representation of Cole mm-hmm. to the people. So it's like, if I tell somebody like he doesn't want to do something, I have to put it in a nice way where they don't come back and be like, yo, that dude J. Cole's an asshole, because then I didn't do my job. So it's like, he might be like, nah, no way, I'm not doing that. And then I have to go back and be like, hey, so listen, we have to, you know what I mean? I gotta, you know, cause you gotta keep those relationships and he's not saying it from a bad place. He's not saying it like shitting on nobody, but to him it's like, why would I do that? So I have to turn around and, you know, put it in a way, because a lot of those people help you get to where you at. A lot of, you know, some relationships don't matter, but you still, like, at the end of the day, you wanna treat people with respect. Mm-hmm. And like, Cole's very, like, aware of his brand. Like, he doesn't want, like, his brand dream, but he doesn't want people to have any bad light or negativity towards it. So it's our job when we go out and reject someone or say no to make sure that we do it in a way that's, like, that's right. Like, it's not like, nah, we good.
Yeah.
You can't do that. Like,
we straight.
You, and you never know what these people going to be. You know what I mean? Yeah. You never know what you might need, you know, that same person. You don't want to be an asshole to them.
Believe that. What do you not like about the actual industry of music? What have you grown to not really like?
I don't like a lot of things about it.
Let's talk about all of it.
Well, I just don't like that it's like, it's too much acting going on, you know what I mean? By the artist and by the people behind, you know, like behind the you know, behind the scenes. Because everybody takes credit for stuff they didn't do, mm-hmm. which I think is kind of whack. And I think the artists are just not being themselves, which kind of hurts them. But it just hurts me to watch. Like, I hate when I see something and I'm like, oh, man, I know why you did that.
Yeah.
That's not a good move, you know? And sometimes it's bad on my part. Like, sometimes I can't just enjoy things because I'm always looking at it like, nah, that was stupid. Right. You know what I mean? Which I shouldn't be doing that all the time. But regardless, I just don't like, that it's so... The first thing people look at is the business side of it now and the money, mm-hmm. that it affects the art and the creativity. And that kind of bothers me. Mm-hmm. And I hate when labels sign people off of numbers. Like, oh, trust me, he going to blow. He got 3 million SoundCloud plays.
Right.
It's like, bro, that's not how it works.
Right.
And, you know, I think it hurts the artist more because labels will jump on certain, and that's only certain labels. There's a lot of great people in these labels. Certain labels will just jump on something that's hot, and then you kind of gave that artist a shelf life of one song. You know what I mean? And I don't like that because that artist has a whole rest of his life mm-hmm. that he has to deal with. Mm-hmm. But all he knows is that one song that made people dance. You know what I mean? And that's like some of the things that bother me about labels in the industry. And I just feel like people are not genuine and they're not being themselves. That's really all it is. If you're being yourself, you can have a career as long as you want because you're only pulling from within. Like, you're only talking about what you feel or what you're seeing or what's happening. If you're being somebody else, you're going to run out of inspiration. You're going to run out of things to talk about because you're like, well, how do I keep up this facade? How do I keep up this lie?
Yeah.
And that's what I don't like about the industry.
Yeah. Y'all should write that down. That's real right there. If you're being yourself, you only have to pull from within. That's deep. Speaking of labels, what's your opinion for an artist who may come up to you and say, Ebe, should I try to sign to a major label or not?
I think that there's like a misconception going around that artists don't need major labels, which it depends on who you are. You know what I mean? At the end of the day, we don't have the money to kick off a career independently, most of us. You know what I mean? Like, me and Cole couldn't do it without a label. At the end of the day, somebody's got to fund you to get you out to the people. Unless you got the dope boys, you know what I mean? Like,
right.
A lot of people don't got that. And then, and you know, so I think that's the misconception. And also, I think that a label could take an artist from, like, middle of the pack to, like, superstardom because they have those means. Now, do I think you necessarily go to a label for them to mold you and give you an idea of what you should do? No, I don't believe that. I believe there's certain people in the labels that know what they're doing and that are always going to help out. But at the end of the day, you don't go to a label to be like, all right, here's the music. How do we get this done?
Right.
You go to a label to be like, here's the music. Here's what I want to do. Here's how I want to do it. Can you help me make this happen? Can you get me to this point? I want to work this song at radio. Working songs at radio is not cheap.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, it's not cheap at all. Like, I get to see all the numbers, so I know, like, there's no way, you know, with the success that we got to do with Boz on Too High to Riot, you know, in a small scale, because he's still a up-and-coming artist, there's no way we could do that at Dreamville with what we have in the bank. Okay. And Interscope helps out. And the Interscope, while they're helping out, you grow a relationship with people in there that give you great ideas and that believe. So I think you do need labels, but I think the way you need labels has changed. I think back in the 90s, labels would be like, yo, you're dope. What we're going to do is, we're going to market you like this, and we're going to put you in front of this crowd. Now it's kind of like, here's what I want to do. Here's what I think. If you have any suggestions, you should be open to all suggestions, but at the end of the day, you should be steering the ship. That's how I look at it.
Word.
What job description comes along with, at this point, you've evolved from just being Cole's manager to now president and what, CEO of...
just president.
President.
Cole's the CEO.
Yeah, president of Dreamville Records. What does that mean in real life? Because we hear people say, oh, you're the president of... This person is the president of this label or that label. What does that mean in real life?
I mean, titles don't mean nothing to me. Like, you know, like, you need a title on paper.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, there's, like, this ongoing joke, this El Presidente joke that Adam started. and then like, Cole said it, so a lot of fans say that. But it's, like, it doesn't really mean anything to me, you know what I mean? Like, everybody that's in our company really kind of the whole, you know, they wear three hats, four hats, whatever needs to be done. So it's not really about titles. It's really just about, what are you going to do to get things done? Like, of course, on paper, you got to put a title in,
right.
You know, but who really cares? Like, I don't walk in a meeting and be like, yo, I'm the president. So, y'all, you know what I mean? Like, nah, it's like, we just going to talk about it as a team. And anybody, I tell people when we was working on Forest Hill Drive and we was going into Rock Nation and tell them what we want to do, one of the best ideas of the whole rollout was given by an intern at the time at Rock Nation who heard my idea and like, well, why don't y'all do this too? And you know, it's like, you never know what idea is going to come from, and you never know what intern or what person is going to be the next, you know, CEO or whatever. So titles don't mean nothing. It's really just like, we all figuring it out. We all working towards the same thing. Mm-hmm. So it's like, the titles don't mean nothing. The responsibility's there. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I feel responsible for every artist that I work with, because I'm just one of those people that's like, if this doesn't work, it's almost like a part of me feels like I fucked up. Mm-hmm. And it hurts me because, like, this is your life. Mm-hmm. So I feel the responsibility of whatever the highest title is going to be. Mm-hmm. But yeah, the titles are just, they're just words.
Dig that. If you had to do this whole journey, because what, did this probably start really taking off around 09, you would say?
09 is when he got signed.
All right.
And then we just spent 2 years of like, what the fuck? Like, like, we knew how to make music, but we weren't ready for, or really the game wasn't ready for us, I should say. You know
okay.
what I mean? Because we came in like making music, and I feel like labels were still, you know, I said this before, and I don't want to feel like I'm shitting on any label, but I feel like at the time labels were, they hadn't caught up to the internet phase or the internet wave that was coming in. And when we came in 2009, we dropped the warm-up. You know, it was Cole and it was Drake. But Drake had the biggest hit in the country. So exactly. you knew what you were doing. It was easy. It was like, you know, Wein put him in the best position to win, and he had a biggest hit. Cole had this crazy buzz, but there was no hit. Mm-hmm. We didn't even know what a hit was. Like, we didn't care. Like, yeah. So I think at the time, labels were like, well, you know, you need a hit. Mm-hmm. You need a hit to put your album out. And I think that's when frustration came in and learning and, you know, just figuring it out. Like, well, what are we going to do? Okay, well, we don't got a hit, so we got to keep things interesting. Like, let's drop another project. Right. Let's drop Friday Night Lights, and fuck, we got to sacrifice some of these songs that we have for the album.
For the album.
You know, and then it's like, you know, oh, well, now we got a hit. Like, this is a hit we can stand by. Okay, we got a date. And I think it was still kind of like figuring it out. And I think once Cole dropped in 2011, it took us 2 years to put out an album.
Mm-hmm.
2.5 years from when we got, from the day he got signed. And it's like, once he dropped and people seen the success, I think that's when labels were like, okay.
Correct me.
These internet guys are on the sun, you know what I mean?
Correct me if I'm wrong. Didn't his first album sell like 217,000 or something like that first week? Yeah.
And I remember like that same week, me and Cole was on a radio run in Texas, and our radio rep was like, you know, labels do like weekly calls, like weekly, you know, A&R meeting calls or whatever. So it was like, yo, Cole, I'm on the call. You should hop on this, you know, say, you know, just say what's up to people. And Cole's like really, Cole's genuinely a super nice person. And he'll genuinely like sit there and have 2 hour conversation with people. So, and he never really, like, he kept good relationships with everybody. So he got on the phone. He's like, hey, everybody, thank you very much. Like, I really appreciate this, you know, like, you know, the fact that you guys are working on this, this means a lot. Thank you. And then, you know, when he got off, it was on speaker, and the guy was like, the head was like, man, that's J. Cole. You know, we got so much love for J. Cole. We're so excited for his album. You know, it's coming out this week. We think he could do anywhere from 65 to 75,000 the first week. And the thing is, that's a lot of sales. But at the time,
bruh,
we're following Drake, and not only that, the internet. This was like the height of the internet, like, J. Cole's never gonna put out an album. Jay-Z don't even know who J. Cole is. Like, you know the jokes.
Yeah.
And we're like, bro, if we come out and do these numbers, we gonna get it. Like, it's gonna be bad. And at the time, we still really cared about what everybody was saying on the internet. We're like, it's gonna be bad. So it kind of hurt. And we were like, yo, I know we put in more work than this.
Yeah.
I know we see 2,000, 3,000 kids at these
shows. At these shows.
Like, this doesn't make sense. Something's not adding up.
Yeah.
But they're the professionals, so they must know.
Mm-hmm.
But I think when the numbers came out, and trust me, we was like, oh, shit. Like, we on that. Like, you know.
Yeah.
But when those numbers came out, I think it changed the game. And I think what it ended up doing is it allowed, you know, someone like, I mean, and I'm not saying it's like taking any credit. I'm saying it allows someone like Kendrick, who's going to be where he's at anyway, to be like, oh, they didn't need to play the game. They have fans, and they fans came out. And I remember, you know, Cole and Kendrick having those conversations around that time. And it allows you to be like, oh, the game has changed. I can make the album I want to make, and this could be commercially successful. You
mm-hmm,
know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And I think after that, you started seeing people not have to play the game as much, because back then it was really like, where is your single?
Yeah. Yeah.
You need a certain amount of spins before you put this album out. You know what I mean? And I think that was the craziest learning process at that time.
Word. Huh. Looking back on all that, is there anything that you would do differently if you had a chance to go back and relive your journey?
I don't think we would have done anything differently in the sense that it kind of taught us and like so much to get us to where we are now.
Uh-huh.
But you know the places. You get. You know, I could look back and be like, yeah, we shouldn't have done that. Okay. Or like, yeah, that was, we forced that one.
Mm-hmm.
Or like, okay, I know why he did that song, because at the time, the pressure was on to like live up to things that were really false. You
right,
know what I mean?
Right.
But I wouldn't say we would change anything. Like his, you know, especially for Cole and for Dreamville, like everything's been on the up and up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there was never like a moment where it was like a dip. Like right now, we just on the up and up. So I wouldn't change anything, you know what I mean?
Believe that. Speak to everyone about the lifestyle, the all-inclusive nature of being a manager, because I'm just going to talk about a couple times that I remember seeing you. You may or may not remember seeing me in these places, but it was doing something different every time. And it's like, just so people know, being a manager isn't a one-dimensional thing.
No, you
know
what I mean? You got to be willing to do any and everything possible to get
so
it done.
So I'm going
to
name something, and you tell me, this is just off the dome. I'm going to name something, and you, if you can remember this, tell me what you were doing at that time or what your function was in that particular moment. This is maybe 2010, maybe. This maybe 2009. I was still a teacher at the time. I think 2010, I was a middle school teacher, but I was on my grind hustling with the music. Y'all were down here doing a radio run at the House of Blues. Yep. I want to say they were pushing Who Dat.
Yep.
I want to say you were the DJ for his set.
For sure.
So talk to him about it. Like, that's part of it.
I don't DJ. I don't know how to DJ, but I knew the music. I knew his music, and I used to like, I was always good with the drops. I used to call myself Drop Master Flex. I was always good with the drops, and what we used to do is like, we just had to figure it out. We didn't have a DJ, and you can't afford to just bring people on the road. Right. So it was like, I remember literally, first of all, we went on a Jay-Z tour at the end of 09. Mm-hmm. I DJed that whole tour for Cole, the 10 minutes that we had before people were even in their seats, off of iTunes, bro. I had an aux cord plug in the arena. I had an aux cord plugged in, and my biggest fear was that, you know, on the MacBook, you hear like the sound of doo-doo-doo.
Yeah.
I was like, please don't let that happen. So
yeah,
I had to make it happen, though. Like, it was just fun. When we started, I was doing drops with the mute button on the laptop.
Dang.
And then the guy I was working with, Jay at the time, John Manilli, he was just like, yo, why don't y'all get a mixer? I was like, yeah, whatever. Like, give me a mixer. I don't know what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And then I remember like Wale, we used to be on tour with Wale and his whole band, UCB at the time, which where we were mad cool with. They used to be like, yo, E, man, you got to move up there and act like you at least mix his son.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I used to be like, I used to look around, just press play and be like.
Right, hey, believe that.
I'll be ready when that job comes. Like, so that was like, but we had to do whatever it took. And, you know, and even now today, up until now, Bob's about to go on tour, but it's like his manager, Derek, was DJing for Bob's up until this tour now where they really going on a real tour. And he was like, all right. It's time to get a real DJ. You know, so it's like, you just got to be able to do whatever you got to do. And I remember that show, too, because Cole was hot off the mixtapes, mm-hmm. and the radio station was trying to have us closed.
Mm-hmm.
But Juvenile was going on before us. We was like, nah.
And now
like,
before
y'all
gotta Juvenile.
Switch that. We in New
in
Orleans.
In New Orleans?
Like, nah. Y'all got to switch that. Yeah. Like, they don't even really know Cole's songs out here. They just know him.
Yeah.
Like, you know, his name was hot, but yeah. Like.
He did Who Dat.
We was doing Who Dat and like, Lights Please. Like,
yeah.
You know, it's like, Juvenile came up and turned it up. We was fans too. We like, yeah. Shit, we just want to watch. Like,
yeah, yeah.
So it was cool. I remember that show.
That's crazy. All right. Another time, this is you in a different role. I remember we were in Tree Sound Studios in Atlanta. This probably 2010, 2011-ish.
Yeah, we was doing Friday Night Lights then.
You was working on Friday Night. So what was your role? Because I was recording. I was working with Jason Gita at the time, Tips yep. manager. And I remember I texted you. I came up, said what's up. I don't know if you remember me and my homie.
For sure. I seen you a bunch of times. We used to always link up.
Yeah. So what was your role when it comes down to like, yo, we in the studio creating. Now, as a manager or as Ebe, what does your role kind of turn to when y'all are in the yo?
Well, to me, that's really where I started from, was being his like A&R. That's really where I came from before the management, was I worked on all the music with him. So it's like my inputs, we did every project, we sequenced it together, you know what I mean? Like we really sit there as a team and like figure it out, what song should be on the album, what song shouldn't be on this, you know, oh, maybe this verse will fit here, you know, oh, maybe we should put, you know, like that's really where I came from. That's really what started me and Cole's like working relationship, you know, before the management thing was that. So that's like my comfort zone. Like when we in the studio, like, you know, a lot of times it'll just be me, him, and like our engineer Mez. And that's like, and then, you know, the musicians that we have, Ron Gilmore was always in there. And to me, that's where we from. Like that's our home, is that studio. So that's really where I really came from. With him is being in there. So that's just me being A&R. I guess that's what they call it nowadays, because I don't know the term, what that term means anymore, but just really just giving my input on the music and helping him make the best project he can make.
Believe that. Do you love the road life, being on the road so much?
It's cool. I like, what I like about it is that you just, around family and friends at all time. And we don't really have unnecessary people around us. You know what I mean? We don't really travel with 5, 10 people that don't have a job. Everybody on our team has a job to do when they're on the road. And then when your job is done, we kick back and it's still the same people that we was with in college. Well, you know what I mean? So that's the beauty of it. And I mean, I look at it like if I wasn't on the road with these people, that still would be who I'd be chilling with. So, you know what I mean? It's tough on, like, you know, your family and relationship life, but, you know, that's a part of it too. So on that part, no. On being with friends and family, yes.
Gotcha. Believe that. I know you're a big sports fan.
For sure.
Definitely. So I was just on the plane. Like, I just literally had a show in Virginia last night. Just flew down here, and I was on the plane thinking, as far as sports, what's your opinion, bro? Who you think is a better team? This year's Warriors, 2016 Warriors, or the 96 Bulls?
Man,
say why.
That's a tough question, to be honest. I think it's closer than a lot of people think. Mm-hmm. I think people don't give the 2016 Warriors as much credit as they should because they're like, oh, they shoot a lot. The game changed. That's what it is. That's, right. But, I mean, Steph Curry is one of the best players I've seen in a long time, but I'm not banned against Michael Jordan, bro. That dude is a killer. Like, and, you know, so, and I think that the Bulls just had, they had three players in, you know, in Jordan, Pippen, and Rodman that could guard, like, any position damn near. You know what I mean? So,
right.
Pippen guarding, like, a Steph Curry or Klay Thompson is tough for them. So
yeah, that's real. That's real.
But Steph has made people like Kawhi Leonard look crazy.
Look super crazy, yeah.
And Kawhi Leonard is nice as fuck, so it's like, you never know.
And then who was the Bulls center? Was it Luke Longley? Was that the Bulls center that year? Yeah, so, I mean, that's the weak link right there for the Bulls.
Yeah, but I mean, Bogut ain't really dropping buckets, like.
Right, he ain't dropping.
He's a good defender. He's going to get you some rebounding blocks, but he ain't really dropping no buckets. So
and what, Ryan Harper? Yeah,
Ryan Harper was nice, though.
He was straight.
Actually, me and Cole was on a flight with Ryan Harper like a while back, all the way in the back of the plane. It was like we was going towards some show, and it was the Final Four, and he was telling us so many stories, like, from the Bulls team.
For real.
And we got cool after that. And every time, like, I would run into him, he's always been, like, the coolest dude. Like, I ran into him in Vegas, so Ron Harper's my man. Like,
believe that.
That's a good guy.
That's dope. That's dope. Football wise, you being from New York, you're a Giants fan? Or?
Nah, you know what? I'm gonna just be honest. I was always a Players fan.
All right.
Which sucks.
That's because
it's like
nowadays.
I was a huge Donovan McNabb fan in college. Then when he got to the Eagles, I was the biggest Eagles fan. Then we went to the Redskins. It was some sad years and the Vikings.
Right.
And I'm just jumping around following him like, you know, and then when he retired, it's like one of my closest homies, Kevin Ogletree, played in the NFL for 7 years. So I just rooted for whatever teams he was on, and he just got finished playing. So it was like, I just really a fan of the sport, but I don't necessarily have a favorite team. Mm-hmm. In basketball, I'm still, you know, the biggest Carmelo Anthony fan. So unfortunately, I'm a Knicks fan.
Word, right? Okay.
It's tough, bro.
I know it's tough, man.
It's
what?
Tough.
I already know. I think everybody out here is entitled to the opportunity to ask any questions y'all may have. I think that'll be cool because this has been wonderful for me. You know what I mean? I think it's cool. I think the things we should take from this, you know, I'm not telling y'all what to memorize, but the things we should take that me as an artist who's still on his grind and making nice moves in the game, the thing that I take from it is this man is selfless. You know, as a manager, like honestly, I'm signed to a label currently. You know what I mean? I deal with people I was in New York this past week. Label meetings, press run, all that. Man, when you find somebody who is so selfless and willing to play any position and who's like, yo, it's the artist's vision. It's not me trying to overimpose myself on it. You know what I mean? And I still want to make it fun at the end of the day for all people involved. As an artist, that's something to really take away in terms of what you should be seeking out. You know, in terms of the business side of everything, if there's any questions, anybody want to ask Eve? Yes, sir.
Peace, I'm Baron, man. I got a two-part question. One, I want to just tell you a gem, bro. Everything you're saying, I'm like, I'm trying to meet somebody that does all that.
Appreciate that, bro.
Yeah, I have a group of friends, and we work like that. But first question is, we oftentimes talk about making it as an artist. And the further I get along, I realize I have to make it. It's not like some kind of dream that somebody's gonna give me. I have to build it. So can you speak on that? And then the other part is the relationship with your manager. Like, should it be an organic thing?
Yeah, I think making it to me is whatever you set out to like do. I don't think it's necessary. Like, making it to me is not a platinum album. If that's what you wanted, then that's making it. So I think making it varies for whoever you are. You know, I think if you just wanted to come through, lock the city down, hey, you made it. You know what I mean? Like, if you want to come through and touch people and really like change, even if it's one person's life through your music, then that's making it. So I think making it varies, because people have different goals in the industry and in music. So to me, I think that's really like, that's a question that changed for everybody. For me, making it was just seeing, you know, how many people Cole can affect with his music and how many people he's touched. That was like, oh shoot, like we made it. And then making it now, for me, changed to, of course, I still have a bunch of goals and Cole still has a bunch of new goals that we want to reach. But then being able to see, you know, these new artists we're working with, like, we just put out Boss album and he's about to go on, you know, a tour throughout the whole country. And that's like, damn, like, we, like, it's happening again with someone else. And I think that's making it varies on who you are and what you're looking for.
All right. Well, and the manager relationship, I'm trying to, I'm looking for one in the I want it to be organic. I don't want to just have to go out and be like, oh, yeah, I want you to manage me. I want to have somebody that I can have that kind of relationship like you and Cole have. So
I think that's, to me, is I always tell people, is like, find a person around you that cares the most about what you're doing. Like, who's over there, like, every day, like, pushing you? Or, like, you know, they might not know nothing about management. Like, right. I knew nothing about management. It was just like, I knew that whatever it took to make this happen, or whatever it was going to take to, like, you know, make his vision come to life, I was going to have to find a way. And sometimes I did it, you know what I mean? Sometimes I couldn't, and then he has to call me out, you know what I mean? Right. That happens, and sometimes, you know, that's part of the game, too. It's like, you're going to learn on the go, but I think find somebody that's, like, truly passionate about what you're doing. I think that's the best person in the world to have on your team.
Appreciate that.
No doubt.
Good morning or good afternoon.
How you doing?
I want to start by saying, Dee-1, I am a college professor working on my PhD, and I love your song. Like, when I first saw it, I was like, oh my God, like, this is what kids need. And I want to say to the both of you, you all are very inspiring. But one of the things that you hit upon that I think is so imperative, and I think you guys should really consider, and I would be more than willing to offer insight on this, is about getting out to PWIs and telling your story. Because I'm a New Orleans native, but I also have a home in St. Louis. And Mike Brown and the condition of black men in America is just, it's incredibly saddening. And I think that so many people need to hear your stories about what you're doing, and you're an incredible facilitator. I'm like, well, you should like be doing television.
I'm trying to rep. Thank you. Thank you.
But yeah, you guys should be. I think you should be out there. I'm a TV personality. I know that there's not sustainability in that career, right? And so I think that people need to hear those stories. Have you ever considered doing more with your foundations or more out there where you're getting out and speaking to college students?
We have Dreaming Foundation. We've done a lot of cool stuff. I mean, personally, I don't feel like I do enough, maybe because of time, but we've done, like, I remember, you know, one of my favorite events we ever did was we bought like a few hundred kids in Fayetteville in the auditorium, and Cole kind of bought all of these young black professionals in different fields and let them speak and take questions, basically, to show kids, especially where he's from in Fayetteville, which is like, you don't have to be a rapper or a basketball player to make it. You know, like, so we had a girl that worked at NASA, and we had a EMT, and our friend who actually did, like, the cover on Forest Hills Drive, one of our friends, he works at an ad agency, mm-hmm. a big ad agency in New York, and he keeps in touch with, you know, one of the kids that reached out. So we try to do those things, and we try to get there as much as we can. I think that the opportunity hasn't necessarily come, like, hasn't come up where people are like, hey, I want you here to talk, but I'm not gonna say and act like I do the most, because I just probably should be doing more, but it's hard.
On my end, so the cool thing about my journey is that I just got into the game because I wanted to be a rapper, but I came from being a full-time teacher. So from day one, I knew that I was just still a teacher. I just had a bigger classroom now and more students, I feel, you know, in the rap game. What has happened over the past few years is my brand has kind of evolved to where I do just as many speaking engagements as I do concerts now. So, like, I'm flying to Clark, Atlanta tomorrow. I have an event on Tuesday, and I'm not performing. You know, I have a whole catalog. I could do a concert, but they booked me to come in and speak on financial literacy to their university. You feel me? And that's a blessing to me. Like, I used to kind of shun that stuff. Like, hold up, I don't see Kendrick or, you know, I never saw, you know, my Juvie doing stuff like that. That's what I'm trying to do, is just rap and be known for that. But I've learned to let God, like, have his way with me and with my path, to where if I'm doing speaking engagements, if I'm hosting, if I'm facilitating, I can still rap as well. So I'm just kind of embracing all of that. And in New Orleans, I'm super active. You know, like there's not a school I probably haven't been to in New Orleans. And if so, I need to go to it, because I need them to see that you can't come from here, because I'm from right out the goose. Everybody know where the goose is, you know what I mean? And look how it turned out. So if I could do it, I know you can do it. You feel me?
I just encourage you guys, and this is something to marinate on, just think third eye, is that you should be in places and spaces that we are not normally at. I went to the University of Missouri Columbia for undergrad and got a degree in communications.
Good job. But you see how you actually were in communications. Right. I was just there. Like.
But to be in those spaces and places, because you are needed. You are needed for these young brothers, and they need to hear you in spots where normally black men do not populate. So I strongly encourage you to give some thought to that. I'll give you my card, and I don't want you to lose touch with me, because I think what you're doing is great. And I have a little black boy, so I take that very seriously.
For sure.
For sure. Appreciate
Thank you.
That.
Appreciate it.
Good evening. Thank y'all for coming out. Appreciate y'all coming out and kind of sharing y'all wisdom and y'all experience right here in New Orleans. That's very important. I'm Queen Cole Medina. I'm a documentary filmmaker. I'm also a rap artist. I did Trouble the Water, which was Academy Award nominated. We won Sundance, a whole bunch of film festival awards. It was about Hurricane Katrina for the most part, and I starred in the film. As an artist, my question to you all is, how do you, like, I done had a whole bunch of success. I do a lot of speaking engagements like you, Dee, and I'm just blessed to have the opportunity to be able to kind of get out there on that speaking circuit and just rap and do all the things I do. But, like, for some of the artists, even myself, even the locals, like, how do you build that management team? Because even recently, I was on, I'm on Beyonce's Formation song, that's my voice at the end, and, you know, just having all these opportunities, and I got my own merchandise, I got music, I just completed another documentary, just completed another album, and it's like, still, like, as an artist, how do you kind of build that team? Because one of the things that I haven't been able to do, but I've been eating, though, like, I've been good, like, I've been speaking, I've been
Believe that, love, believe that.
Like, it's like, I really don't need a whole big team out there,
yeah,
because I'm good.
Yeah.
But it's like, I still haven't been able to kind of build that team as an artist, as a multi-talented artist, to kind of take that level. I mean, take my artist, my music, and everything to that next level. Mind you, my song, Trouble the Water, was also Academy Award nominated for Best Original Song. So, like, I had, like, a lot of my success in the film industry. You get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And I haven't really been able kind of to tap that music, but I'm a rapper first.
Right.
You feel what I'm saying? But it's like, what's your advice to, like, artists like myself and just even the locals? Like, how do you kind of build that team to take what you have, your multi-talented abilities to the next level to kind of reach that,
right,
you know what I'm saying, that mainstream?
I take this one. Yo, it's hard in New Orleans. It's so hard down here to find that right team, period, point blank. If y'all don't like the answer, we need to change the culture down here, because it's so hard. The only person that's been with me throughout my journey, she's sitting right here on the front row with the camera in hand, playing her role, not trying to be all, you know, like, all, and that's Fatima, you know what I mean? And this, I met her when my best friend got murdered, you know what I'm saying? And that's my sister at this point, been around. She didn't go to school for this. She didn't, you know, like know about this, but so selfless, you know, so humble, so willing to just be like, yo, what's needed? She picked me up from the airport today, you know what I mean? Like, she is whatever. That's how we rock. In New Orleans, that is so rare that when you find that, you know, I only found one, and I've been grinding since probably 07, 08 down here. You know, I only find one. You stick close to them. Other than that, you might have to spread your wings, because down here, it's tough. And I'm not bashing anybody down here, but I'm telling the truth about the culture, because people might not understand what you do. Mm-hmm. That's the other thing. They're going to understand that money, so sometimes you're not stunting. You're just showing people, yeah, I'm eating out here. And that's going to make them kind of notice, because with me, a lot of people didn't understand that he's cool, he's nice, but he rapping on some positive stuff. Wait, he don't curse in his music. Wait, we never saw that in New Orleans. But then when they start to see, oh, he got signed. Oh, he on BET. Oh, he really making money. Oh, he don't teach no more. He making more than, you know what I mean?
Nobody respected until everybody don't get,
you know, like everybody, Wild Wayne knows what my first breakout song down here was. It's called One Man Army. Because that's how I felt walking around this city, like a one-man army. So all I would tell you is stay prayed up and stay encouraged that you are doing the right thing. Those results are not a fluke. As far as other people in this city taking notice and wanting to be a part of it, that may or may not happen. And if it don't happen, don't stop, sweetheart. Don't stop.
Man, I'm grinding.
I couldn't have said it better than that. But I just feel like the same way he used her for an example is the same relationship I had with Cole, in the sense, like, just find people around you, and I told the other guy the same thing, just find people around you that they care so much, they're so attached to what you're doing, that you just promote them almost. Like, and it's not like you tell them, like, it's not like you see they be like, you know what, you're going to be my manager. It's like, just allow them in, slowly. Let them slowly get more and more responsibilities, you know? Yeah. I have a friend of mine that I've been best friend with since sixth grade, and it's like, now he works in Dreamville. He's a part of the team, but he was here for like 4 or 5 years before, you know, running around with us, and then it was like, oh shit, why is he not working with us? He knows what he's doing, and it's kind of like you allow people more and more responsibility, and you just like allow them to do more and let them kind of grow into that role. And I'm sure there's somebody around you that really cares. That's so every day, like, yo, we should do this, we should do that. That's the person to me, if you're asking me.
Yeah, you're right. Well, thank y'all, man. Appreciate that.
No problem.
This is up.
Hey, how's it going? I got a bunch of different questions running through my head. But just out of curiosity, because even J. Cole, Dee-1, you are two artists with very strong voices, and I heard you talking about the vision, the artists, you know, it's important for everyone to have a vision. And, you know, I like the fact that J. Cole's on Rock Nation, and it seemed like Dreamville is under another umbrella. Mm-hmm. And then Dee-1, I know you signed with recently signed to a major. So how does that play a role? Where do you find the merger between having a strong voice and a vision, and then finding that blend, a balance with business or this big conglomerate, and still feeling that support or still budging or still having that voice, you know, still being the rapper that doesn't curse and promotes that positive message, doesn't conform? You know, how do you maintain the vision and find that balance?
I think for us as a team personally, we knew what we wanted, and sometimes when you go into a situation, you have to explain that from jump. Like with Cole at Rock Nation, it took us a while because, you know, they were still learning too. They were a new company, so it was like we were both learning. And, you know, I think it also helped that you have artists up there in Jay that kind of trusted Cole's artist side. But as far as Dreamville, the label, when we went in there, me and Cole, from jump, we were kind of like, this is how we want our label to be. It's going to take longer. You're not going to get a smash hit off the jump. It's going to take longer, but we're trying to build artists to have a long career and be themselves and be able to say what they want to say. And thankfully for us, we had somebody like, you know, Joey I.E., who's over there, who's the president over there, who kind of believed that, reached out to us, seen what we wanted to do, and then was like, okay, I'm going to trust you guys. I'm going to be here to help you guys. So it's all about relationships. Like, I think in every business situation we've been in, there's been people that I could point to be like, this relationship has helped me get through what we want to do because they could explain it to the other side for us. You know what I mean? Like, so I think that was a big part, is like that trust. When Cole did it, right? Not that all of our artists are gonna have a different path and do different things, but when Cole did it, that was, I feel like, enough of a clout to be like, look, we kind of know what we're doing. It might not work the same for the next artist, but let us give it a shot our way, because we don't want to do it their way. You know what I mean? Like, and when I say they, I just mean, I'm not Khaled or nothing, but when I say they, I just mean in the sense that, you know, how other people think it should be done, or, you know, the way mainstream tells you should be done. We kind of want to carve our own lane and do it our own way. And then I feel like in that way, it kind of grows into a position where artists can build a career off of it and not just be here today and gone tomorrow.
What was the question?
I was just finding that blend between the business side of it and your vision, and kind of maintaining and holding on to that vision.
Yeah, it's for me, it was being successful before I walked into a corporate office building. And the success that I had ascertained on my own made it to where I could call the shots to a certain extent walking in there. It's a lot of heavy egos inside the buildings. I just had a very, you know, potentially career-altering meeting on Wednesday with my label and whatnot. And it's a long story, and I don't know. You think I might not need to tell it right now. Nah, all right. I'll be smart. All right. I'll tell you after, Jill. But, yeah, that being said, it is about you have to know. See, I just look at everything like, yo, life is temporary, man. And especially coming from down here, we don't know how much longer we have on this earth. So I look at it like this industry is just a sliver of the totality of my life. With that being said, nothing about being in this industry should take me away from my greater life mission and life purpose. So that's why it's easy for me to maintain my morals and my standards for the type of man and artist I want to be. And that's the type of talk that when they hear you talking like that, they're like, oh, we're not going to be able to change his mind. Like, he's gonna do what he wants to do. But it helps when they see stuff like Sally Maybach with millions of hits online, and they see they didn't believe in that song. I played it for them in October. You know what I mean? They said, oh, this is corny. People don't want to hear this. Your fans don't even go to college probably. You know, say all this. And then they see me pop up on The Real, the daytime talk show. Like, all this is not what they publicists. This is not where any of that. So they see this, and then it's equivalent to selling 217 your first week out. It's a notch of saying, I'm not trying to, like, you know, talk down on y'all, but maybe I know what I'm doing. You know what I'm saying? And the more you get that clout and you still maintain your professionalism, they start to slowly but surely say, all right, cool. We're going to stop talking down on him like he's our child and start talking equal to him like he's a man. And that's what I think the tug of war is back and forth. You know what I mean? But you just got to be strong.
Gotcha. So there's like a balance between doing stuff on your own still and almost like proven to get that cooperation.
Being signed, and they told me Wednesday, they said, look, bruh, you know how it goes. Even though you signed, you still got to do it all on your own pretty much. That's what they told me. Gotcha. I'm like, yo, for y'all to be saying this, that's crazy. Because you would think that, oh, okay, you with the label there. And when they say do it on your own, I'm talking about shoot your own music videos, pay to put yourself, you know, on the road. It's not always tour support money that they're going to open up. So it's still a lot. You have to be independently major, I think, if you're going to sign a deal. You know what I mean? And it's just knowing how to finesse the situation, you know? And
that's how we look at our situation. We always say we're an indie label that just got major backing. You know what I mean? But even then, you don't want to. Here's the thing. Every penny you spend, you got to make back. It's not like it's, you know, it's not free money. So you got to be smart in how you spend it. You got to be smart how you deal with them. You just got to be smart in what you just got to follow your vision and not stray away, because once you stray away from your vision and you using somebody else's vision, or you're like listening to what they tell you, you're gonna hate yourself if it doesn't work. You know, I remember when we were putting out Four Sales Drive, it was kind of like we had all these ideas. We're like, we're gonna do it this way. We're gonna do it this way. We're not gonna put out no music before the album comes out. And if it fails, we're gonna look at each other and be like, we failed our way, instead of like, we failed your way, because then we're just gonna blame you. You know what I mean? So. And it, thank God it worked out. It worked out great. But if we would have failed, we'd have been like, you know what? Cool. That was on us. We can get up and like dust ourselves off and go at it again. And I think that's just the most important part, is following your vision and being open enough to allowing the label kind of chime in on it, but know like we're not gonna do what you want. But if you have a good idea, I'm all ears. You know what I mean?
Gotcha. All right, appreciate it. Thank you.
Oh, what's going on? I had a question. I wanted to know, what's your opinion on like how music distribution is changing with like companies like Apple and Tidal kind of competing for exclusive, release rights, or where do you see that going?
Personally, I hate it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I don't think music should be exclusive to anything. You know, I think we go through battles with labels right now, with like SoundCloud. Like now SoundCloud is starting to pull stuff down off of theirs. And I get it, it's a business, but personally I don't like it. I think music and art is meant to be like seen or heard by as many people as possible. So it's like to tell somebody like you could only get, maybe I shouldn't be saying this, but to tell somebody like you could only get something on this platform, I don't think that's fair to fans, but it's not. Sometimes it's not on the artist. Maybe the artist doesn't have a choice, but to me personally, I just don't like it.
I feel the same way as Ebe. I think it's difficult when music is kind of being force fed to certain platforms, and those platforms you have to pay. You know, like the only way you can consume the music as if you're paying for that service or something like that. I think it's tough. I think that there's always a sensitive nature that we have to understand about the music business. The business is revolved around making money. Like the people who work at labels, they're not the devil, man. You know, it's not like
they just try to keep their jobs.
Yeah, I've had a radio person literally have to call and make some calls to program directors to get a certain record played. And after that, she hung the phone up and she looked at me. She was like, man, I hate that record. I hate it. But I just heard her make 30 calls to program directors to get it played. But she personally hates it, but it's her job. So they're always just trying to find a way, because they make a lot less money now than they used to when we were little boys. And
for sure.
They make a lot less money.
The money's not, I think, the artists are making more money. Mm-hmm. The mm-hmm. labels in the business are not, so they got to find a way to monetize it. And to me, it's you could allow it as an artist or as a person to hurt the art or the music, but there's ways around it. Yeah. I think at the end of the day, an artist just focus on making the best music, and it'll get out there. It's just it's some roadblocks, but it's ways around it, I think.
Thanks.
My name is Michael. I'm a guitar player. Thanks both of you for doing this. It's been really enlightening.
Oh, no problem.
My question is mainly for Ibe. You mentioned as a manager not wanting to be like Puffy or Birdman and be really visible.
He
and
said that.
Like an artist.
<He's not mad laughs> Throw that charge on me. Throw
and Birdman.
Throw that charge on
me. Respect.
Well, it was you. I think it was you then who mentioned sometimes one of your least favorite things about the music industry is you said there's a lot of acting going on, and you see people doing things and you can see through their motivations for it, and you have trouble just experiencing things kind of on a pure enjoyment level anymore. So just those two ideas combined, have you seen Birdman's Breakfast Club interview? And do you have any insight for why he would want to do something like that?
That's Ibe's question. That's Ibe's question. Go ahead.
Bro, I'm in New Orleans, bro. That's set up.
Yeah, good answer.
I mean, I think at the end of the day, like, I don't know the situation. I don't know why he said what he said. I don't know what was going on between him and Charlamagne. But, I mean, he's a grown man. He made his decision. It is what it is. I don't think that was necessarily acting.
Yeah,
I think that was a real feeling, and real, he was really feeling a certain way. And sometimes, if that's how you want to approach it, that's how you want to approach it as a man. That's
it's
on him.
It's just weird, show business being what it is, you really never know. And I mean, he's, whatever that sort of thing does to his personal life, he went viral over it.
Believe
you can't
that.
Get on social media without seeing him right now. And like for the past few years now, it's like Wayne's been trying to distance himself from him. And he explicitly threatens the DJ, who then laughs at him. So cool. You gotta wonder,
yeah,
you know,
that's between them, bro.
Yeah,
you
know? I appreciate it.
You gotta wonder how real that really is. I mean, this guy is an entertainer.
Got love for Birdman Wein.
And he did.
Right, right. Believe that. Thank you.
I don't know.
Thank you, my brother.
Thank you, bro.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
What's up, man? Thank you. Thank you for being on the panel. Really enlightening. I had two quick questions. Getting attention is hard. Keeping attention is harder, in my opinion, especially in the industry.
Yeah, man. That's real as fuck. You know, getting attention is hard. And I think what we learned, you know, as a team because of, like, what we went through was once you got the attention, keeping attention is hard because it depends on who you're targeting. You know what I mean? What we started doing was real easy. We was like, look, we have, no matter if it's Cole or if it's Boss or if it's Kaz or if it's Omen, you have your pool of fans. Get them excited, make them feel like they're the luckiest fans in the world, and let them do the talking for you. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And I think once we realized that, we was like, oh, that. And worst come to worst, if you don't gain one new fan, like, you're blessed to have these fans. Like, fans are not guaranteed, so you're blessed to have that. And I think focusing on that is the way to keep your fans. And then also point importance on making sure you make the right music. You know what I mean? You can't stray away and you know, make bad music or make music that's not really you, because they'll see through it. So I think keeping it is hard, but it just depends on what you're trying to keep. Like, if you know who you're speaking to, it'll be easy.
And real quick, second part of it is in terms of, I think part of the people liking J. Cole is also similar to a D is his humility. And I think that comes off in yourself as well, which is probably why y'all are a good team. But the question is more so about, does he have any endorsements? And when it comes to any type of endorsements or partnerships that he works with, how do his ethics and whatnot come across in that? Like, translation marketing does a lot of artists to brand stuff. So
I know, we've dealt and talked to a lot of these people, and we have things coming up, but I think it's always what we learn, because we've done small things here and there, and we're doing other things coming up, is what we learn is, what I learned is off jump, I'm going to tell you what he's willing to do and what he's not willing to do. And if you still want to do this deal, let's do it. But if not, cool. Like, we don't have a problem. Like, you know, there's a lot of things that we've turned down or not done because it just doesn't fit, you know? Certain things fit, and, you know, it might not fit all the way, so we have to scale it down. Like, look, maybe we'll do it. We'll be willing to do this. You know, I think a lot of brands now know that he's not going to do interviews. Like, they know he's not going to tweet. He's not going to tweet your, you know, he's not going to be like, yo, go get this new blah, 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 you know, unless he feels like it or unless it makes sense for him, you know what I mean? And I think it's really just on keeping the artist's vision and his morals and everything he stands for intact. But of course you're going to work with other brands, and there's other things that you're going to want to get accomplished. So you go through that, and then you got to know to use those brands for what you want too. You know what I mean? So yeah, it's just about setting the boundaries, like, from off jump.
Thank you.
How y'all doing? This for both of y'all. I know y'all got to wrap up. Okay. My question is, how important is integrity and character as far as maneuvering in the industry and maintaining, you know, yourself in that sense?
Oh, man, it's the most important thing, because then you don't have to upkeep something that you're not. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? If you're just moving around the industry, I mean, bro, Cole just went to the White House in sweatpants. Like, that's who he is.
Yeah.
He's not going to change for nobody. And to me, it's like, once you set that bar, you don't have to act and be somebody else in front of people, because that's the hardest job, to act like someone else. You know what I mean? So I think moving the way we move, like, Chase will tell you, like, how many stories coming up, he be like, bro, why y'all act like y'all not on? Like, he's like, we didn't get security till, like, the second album. Like, you know, he just moves around, and, you know, the way he moves. And to me, that's just, like, you be yourself first and let everything else work out, work around that. You know what I mean? Because once you're somebody else, like, you're fucked.
Now, he said it perfectly. You don't have to get in character or in costume every day when you're being yourself. So My thing is, I put my stuff out there, and I think people respect you more for it. So I always put out there that I drive a 1998 Honda Accord. You know what I mean? It's gonna make some people laugh. It's gonna make everybody else say, "Well, that's different." But I respect him. He put it out there. What if I was putting out there, man? I got the new Range Rover. You heard me? The 2017. Da 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 da. Then every time I go to an event, I gotta park 2 miles away. You know what I'm saying? And it, so nobody see what I'm hopping out of. Like, that stuff is too much to keep up.
It's
also,
a job, damn near.
Yeah, that's a job. That's a job. And also, the type of music you put out, man, really attracts that type of energy. So, you know, I'm in New York 2 days ago. I'm on the train. You know what I mean? Some people on the train like, "Man, ain't you D1? Like, what you doing? Da, da, da." But the type of music I put out is always peaceful vibes when people approach me, man. Somebody could pull up on me at the gas station in New Orleans at night, hoodie on, you heard me, hop out, gold teeth, and they'd be like, "Dog, I love your music, dog. I rock with you." And I'd be like, "Yo, that's a byproduct of the type of energy I put out." So I think with artists like myself and Cole, that's one thing we have in common. People not coming up to us saying, "Oh, he talk hard in them songs. I'm going to see if he bout that life." Yeah. It's like, nah, he talks real in his songs, and he's a humble, you know, person. So I'm going to approach him and respect him off jump. And that's a blessing, man. That right there
is real.
Saves a lot of stress and a lot of money. You know, like, you don't have
definitely to, a lot of money. A
lot of money, dog.
There's a lot of people blowing money flying private that don't need to be flying private.
Straight up. Believe that. So, good question.
Thank y'all. I appreciate it.
All right, thank you.
Yeah. Well, this has been real, y'all. Y'all make some noise for Eve. You hear me? Make some noise for Eve.
Right, so, everybody, once again, Mr. Ibrahim Ibe Hamad.
Yep.
And an incredible moderating job by our own D1. Just really rock solid. Both of you, thank you. This has been an incredible panel.